Welcome to the fourth lesson in the Google Tag Manager training series. In this lesson, you'll learn about migrating to Google Tag Manager. We will review my checklist to ensure everything is ready before publishing your container. I'll also cover one important obstacle people face when migrating. If you've missed the previous lessons, you can find links to them in the description below this video. The lessons cover how to get started, plus adding and testing tags. The steps you'll need to take to migrate your implementation to Google Tag Manager will depend on the tags you currently have on your website. For example, migration will be fairly straightforward if you only use the Google tag and haven't made any customizations to the data it collects. However, if you have added customizations to your website's Google tag and other tags, you'll need to plan your migration. Before we cover the different scenarios you might encounter, let's cover one of the biggest obstacles people face when migrating. This is understanding what the Google tag is. The Google tag can be confusing because it can refer to different things. First, the Google tag can be the dedicated tag you use to install Google Analytics on your website. It looks something like this. It can be confusing because we can see the tag refers to googletagmanager.com, but this isn't actually the Google Tag Manager code. Apart from the comment above the tag, the giveaway is that the script includes references to GTag, which is short for Google Tag. The Google Tag can also be the dedicated tag you use to send data to Google Ads. Here we can see the Google Tag for Google Ads. The only difference to the tag we were just looking at is that the tag ID starts with AW. So this tag will send data to Google Ads. So this code is the Google tag. It was also previously called the Global Site Tag, gtag.js, or even the Google Analytics tag or the Google Ads tag. And to add to the confusion, we can also find the Google tag inside Google Tag Manager. Here we can see the option to create a Google tag, as we've covered in the previous lessons. So if you're using the first option we looked at and you want to use Google Tag Manager, you will need to follow the migration steps we're going to cover. However, if you're already using the Google tag inside Google Tag Manager, you might already be up and running. However, it's still important to check that the migration steps we will cover have been followed. Okay, now that we've covered the difference between the two types of Google tags, let's walk through some of the different scenarios you might encounter. The simplest scenario is if you're just getting started. For example, if you're launching an entirely new website and you don't have an existing Google Analytics property. In this case, you can set everything up from scratch in Google Tag Manager. You will create your property, get your measurement ID from Google Analytics, and configure your tags in Google Tag Manager. Then there is the scenario of just adding the standard Google tag to your website. You might be using a plugin, or maybe you've added the tag directly to your website, but you're just using the standard tag and you haven't made any customizations to your tracking. In this case, you can add the Google Tag Manager code in parallel to the existing tag. Replicate the tag in Google Tag Manager, then publish your container and remove the existing tag. The next scenario is if you're using a modified Google tag or you've implemented customizations. For example, if you've added the tag to your website and you've configured e-commerce tracking. In this case, you'll need to replicate the Google tag in Google Tag Manager, and you'll also need to ensure Google Tag Manager is configured to capture your e-commerce transaction details and pass them to Google Analytics. And continuing this scenario, you might have implemented additional customizations, like custom parameters to collect custom dimensions and metrics. You will need to take extra time to ensure that these customizations are implemented using Google Tag Manager before you remove any existing tags from your website. And apart from Google Analytics, you'll also need to look for any other tags and any other third-party code you've added to your website. In most cases, these can also be migrated to Google Tag Manager. For example, if you've added tags for other analytics platforms like Hotjar, and tags for advertising platforms like the LinkedIn Insight tag and the Metapixel for Facebook. Now let's run through my migration checklist. Depending on the current tags that have been added to your website, you can customize this checklist. If you want to download a copy of my Google Tag Manager guide that includes this checklist, you can find a link to get the guide in the description below this video. Step 1 is to create a list of your existing tags. This should include your Google tag and any other tags you've added to your website. It's also a good idea to make a note of how the tags are added to your website. For example, you might be using a plugin to add Google Analytics to your website, and maybe you've added the Metapixel by pasting it into your website's template. Step 2 is to create a list of any tracking customizations you've made. For example, you might have implemented e-commerce tracking to record the items people purchase on your website. Or you might have modified the Google tag to send data to Google Analytics and Google Ads simultaneously. Or maybe you've adjusted the Google tag to send custom events and custom parameters to Google Analytics. Step 3 is to document your current implementation. It can be helpful to create a spreadsheet that contains all of the tags and customizations. This spreadsheet documents different tags currently used on a website, so you can have a full view of all the elements you need to implement in Google Tag Manager. Creating a spreadsheet like this is optional, but it's useful if you have multiple tags and customizations you need to migrate to your container. Step 4 is to add the Google Tag Manager code to all of your website's pages. The way you add the container code will depend on the website platform you're using. For example, if you're using WordPress, you might use a plugin to add the code to your pages. Or if you're using Squarespace, you'll use the code injection option to add the code. In the first lesson, we walked through adding the container code to our website, so feel free to re-watch the first lesson if needed. I've included a link in the description below this video. Step 5 is optional. It's to work with your web developer to add a custom data layer to your website. A custom data layer makes information available to Google Tag Manager. For example, if you're using an e-commerce platform that doesn't provide a Google Tag Manager integration, you'll want to implement a custom data layer that includes transaction details. This means that when a transaction occurs, you can pass all of the transaction details to Google Analytics, Google Ads, and any other tags where you want to send e-commerce data. Step 6 is to check that variables have been enabled or created for any information you want to use in your tags and triggers. For example, if you want to track people clicking on a particular website promotion, you might need to enable the click classes or click ID variables so you can make use of the classes or ID of the element someone clicks on your website. Step 7 is to create all of your tags in Google Tag Manager. This is where you take all of your notes from step 1, 2, and 3 and add all of the tags you're using to your container. Step 8 is to apply appropriate triggers to your tags. For example, when you add the Google tag for Google Analytics, you can use the built-in initialization all pages trigger. This will mean the tag is added to every page of your website. Then for any tags that need to fire on individual pages or for specific actions, you'll need to create custom triggers in Google Tag Manager. Triggers can be created based on a range of actions, from the page someone is viewing, to the element they click, to watching an embedded YouTube video. There are lots of different types of triggers you can create. If you'd like to learn more about the different types of triggers you can create, check out the extra resources in the description below this video. I've included a link to my Google Tag Manager glossary. Step 9 is to integrate your consent management platform, so your cookie banner, with your tags. The way you do this will depend on how you're adding the cookie banner to your website and the tags you're using in your container. Once integrated, most of Google's tags can be configured to automatically adjust their behavior based on people's consent preferences, while other tags might need to be blocked if consent isn't granted. we will cover integrating a cookie banner with Google Tag Manager in a future video. Step 10 is to test all of your tags using the preview mode. We covered Tag Assistant and the preview mode in the previous lesson. If you missed it, I've included a link in the description below this video. Finally, step 11. Once you're happy with the tags, triggers, and variables you've added to Google Tag Manager, it's time to publish your container. The important thing to remember is that when you publish your container, you should remove any tags that are still hard-coded on your website. For example, if you've added the Google Tag Manager container code to your website, and you also have the Google tag on your website, you should remove the Google tag when you publish the container. This is because you will now have the tag in Google Tag Manager, and you don't want it to be duplicated on your website. Once you've followed these steps and migrated to Google Tag Manager, you can add new tags to your website without needing to adjust any code. And when you do make changes, don't forget to preview and test your changes before they're published. If you'd like to continue learning about Google Tag Manager, please subscribe to this channel if you haven't already. In the next lesson, we'll cover conversion tracking using Google Tag Manager. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.